I believe a dark tidal wave is on the horizon. It's a wave of hostility and persecution that is about to crash onto the church. We have been conditioned not to expect persecution. It's because I know how dangerous, how difficult persecution can be, that I have such a sense of urgency for the United States. I'm focusing on preparation of the heart to be faithful till the end. Hello, I'm Andrew Brunson. In this series, I'm going to be talking about preparing to stand in difficult times. My wife, Noreen, and I lived in Turkey for 25 years, starting churches, a house of prayer, and working with refugees. Our lives were turned upside down one day when we were invited to the local police station and told that there was an order to arrest and deport us. The problem is they never got around to deporting us. They released Noreen after 2 weeks, but they held on to me for 2 years. They accused me of being a military spy, a terrorist, of trying to overthrow the Turkish government. And none of this was true. They wanted to make an example of someone in order to intimidate other Christians, and they chose me. They threatened to give me 3 life sentences in solitary confinement. I thought of myself as a relatively tough missionary. We had faced threats before, I had been shot at once, but I was not prepared for what I experienced in prison. It was much more difficult than I imagined it would be, and I almost didn't make it through. Persecution almost knocked me out. It's because I know how dangerous, how difficult persecution can be, that I have such a sense of urgency for the United States. I believe a dark tidal wave is on the horizon. It's a wave of hostility and persecution that is about to crash onto the church. Now, many Christians do not think this can happen in America, but it can. Many followers of Jesus throughout history and in many countries have experienced persecution. In fact, our experience in the U.S. of very little persecution up to now is the exception. I believe this is because of the faithfulness of generations before us. Although we've had many sins and mistakes as a nation, many people honored God, and many leaders did this publicly. But I think everyone can see that our society has changed significantly in the last generation or two. What I call the commanding heights of our culture, the corporate world, big tech, arts, media, entertainment, professional sports, schools and universities, government bureaucracy, they're mostly populated by people who do not honor God, and in fact, many openly defy Him. And these are the people who control the centers of power and influence. They have the platforms to amplify their voices and shape public opinion. And they're increasingly hostile to those who identify clearly with Jesus and His teaching. I want to underline that I'm not talking about politics. I'm not thinking of this as an issue of right versus left, but rather followers of Jesus on the one hand, and on the other, those who are hostile to followers of Jesus. I think there are 2 wedge issues that will drive persecution. First, the exclusivity of Jesus and salvation, that Jesus is the only way to God. And second, that Jesus demands obedience from His followers in a number of areas that are hotly contested in our culture, such as sexual morality, gender identity, marriage, family, life, and biblical justice. Those who are faithful to Jesus in these 2 areas are going to be labeled as evil people. And those who persecute us will justify themselves saying that we are hate groups, that we carry a message of hate. Now this, of course, is completely backward. It's a satanic lie. But think of Jesus. Jesus was the most loving and kind man in history, but people called Him evil. They said He was demonic. And an angry mob demanded He be killed in a gruesome way. And Jesus said that just as the world hated Him, the world will also hate His followers. And it's true. Christians are the most persecuted religious group in the world. Why? It's because when we walk closely with Jesus, we carry His scent, and people are reacting to Him in us. I think this is some of what will happen. In the name of being exclusive and tolerant. Many will say that the followers of Jesus are a threat to safety, and this has consequences in our culture. They'll say, you can't work here. Your views make people feel unsafe. You can't use social media. You can't use our financial products. We won't process your payments. We're canceling your bank account. You can't use these credit cards. And as for your church, we're closing down your website and your podcast. And actually, that's not enough. We're stripping you of your tax-exempt status because you have a message of hate. These are some of the possible pressure points. You can be silenced, marginalized, shamed, canceled, deplatformed. So there's social and financial pressure. And there are steps beyond this. I don't know how far it will go. But even if it's just being despised and hated and slandered, that can be difficult enough. Several of the examples I gave have already been applied to a few individuals and ministries. For now, we still have robust legal protections for freedom of religion. But as the commanding heights of our culture turn against our Judeo-Christian heritage, these protections can erode very quickly. And when we reach a tipping point, it will accelerate very quickly across a wide front. The reason I'm doing this series is because I have this sense of urgency. And it's because the majority of believers are not ready for the pressures of persecution. And this is very dangerous. I can tell you this from personal experience. I came close to failing, especially during my first year in prison. At times I was suicidal. I was overcome with fear and despair. I went into relational crisis with God. Now, one of the purposes God had in my imprisonment was that I learned how to stand under pressure even when I was weak and overwhelmed. And this was in part so that I could encourage others to stand when they're under pressure, to encourage you. Now, I would prefer to carry a different message, a lighter and happier message. But this is a message God has assigned to me and that He prepared for me. So in this series, I will highlight some of the spiritual dangers ahead and suggest some steps we can take to prepare ourselves to stand. Now, this is not a comprehensive list, but these are things that I learned in practice that helped me to endure under intense pressure, and I believe they will help you also. Now, when I mention preparing for hardship, some people immediately think of practical things like having a generator, storing up food, or having cash on hand. And there's nothing wrong with practical steps like this. But I'm focusing on preparation of the heart, which is much more important and fundamental in determining whether we will stand faithful. And that is the ultimate goal, to be faithful till the end. In this session, I want to talk about the first step to prepare to stand under pressure. And it's very basic. In fact, it's what we've just been doing. We need to talk about persecution, be aware of it, and plan for it. It needs to be on our radar screen. And I say this especially for pastors, for leaders, for influencers, for parents and grandparents, because you have people under your care. If we don't talk about it, then when that dark wave hits, it is going to shock many people, and that places them in danger of being knocked out. This is especially true because persecution is different from other trials. There are many pressures that we cannot easily escape. An illness, grief from a loss, a broken relationship. It simply isn't an option. But persecution is different because the pressure will usually stop if you just compromise. And this is why we prepare ourselves ahead of time, so that when pressure comes and we are afraid, we do not run, but stand firm. Here are some of the things you can do. Read the New Testament with a different eye. It's full of exhortations to prepare and also examples of people living victoriously under persecution. In prison, I especially read 2 Timothy, which Paul wrote in a dungeon before he was martyred. 1 Peter addresses Christians who are suffering for doing good. Read the Gospels with a focus on what Jesus says about persecution, how he himself deals with persecution, and how he prepares his disciples. Make decisions now and discuss with your loved ones that as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. even if it becomes costly. Also, begin to pray now that you and your loved ones have enough faith and strength to stand. This is what Jesus urged his disciples to do. He said, "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." And Peter says to believers facing persecution, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." Also, learn from the persecuted, those who've gone before and endured faithfully. We have been conditioned not to expect persecution in this country, so we need to change our mindset. This is not a time for ministry as usual in the church. Many churches are looking at how to expand, but very few are getting ready for the wave that is about to hit. Some of my friends are expecting a revival, and I hope it comes. I hope there's another great awakening. But before we see revival fire, I think we will go through a refining fire. So we need to prioritize preparing ourselves right now. Early in my detention, my mother was allowed to visit me, and she said to me, "Andrew, there's a long line of people who have suffered for Jesus Christ. It's a very long line stretching back 2,000 years. My son, it is now your turn to stand in that line." This was a difficult thing to hear, but it was the right perspective. Accept that you may have to stand in that line. The hard truth is that God allows his children to suffer persecution, and it can be more difficult than we think. I had an idealistic view of how I would handle intense persecution like imprisonment, and looking back, I think it would have helped me to know how difficult it can be so that I could adjust my mindset and expectations. I hear some people saying confidently now, "Persecution will be good for us." They say it almost with a sense of bravado. "It will build a church. Bring it on." We need to be careful not to be overconfident. I say to you again, it can be more difficult than we think. And God's faithfulness, his help, his grace, they may look different than we would expect. Let me give you a couple of examples. Paul declared confidently in 2 Timothy, and this is one of my favorite verses, "The Lord will rescue me from every evil deed and bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom." But when he wrote this, he was suffering in a miserable Roman dungeon. He was expecting to be executed. So safety and being rescued may look a bit different than we imagined. And Jesus tells his disciples that they're going to face persecution, they'll be hated by everybody, some of them will be imprisoned, some of them will be put to death. And then after giving them this long list of terrible things that can happen to them, he says, "Yet not even a hair of your head will perish." So escaping harm may not look the way I expected. I've mentioned that I broke my first year in prison. I broke thoroughly, I broke repeatedly. And I thought I might be one of the very few who struggled as I did. I wondered what was wrong with me. But I've learned since being released that many others who've been imprisoned for their faith have an experience similar to mine. And many come out crushed spiritually and in other ways. And they're not fully restored in this life. It is not all victory like we're used to reading about in biographies. We're human and we break. And somehow, God allows it. I don't know that any of you will go to prison for your faith, but whatever persecution you may face, it will be difficult enough. There is a cost. In saying this, I do not want to inspire fear. That is not what Jesus did, what he warned about persecution. Rather, I encourage us to be sober-minded and to strengthen our hearts so that we're prepared, so that we have a right perspective and can remain faithful. This can be a heavy subject, And especially because it can be a discouraging subject, we need to keep before us the truth of the supremacy of Jesus, the image of Jesus as the lion. He will not be defeated. So yes, there is a dark tidal wave that is about to crash onto the church, and it's full of the anger of Satan. We need to take this seriously because he wants to destroy the church, and Jesus warns that many will be tempted to turn away in the midst of difficulties. Not everyone is going to remain faithful. But God is not going to allow Satan to destroy the church. In fact, he's going to use this dark wave in a redemptive way. God will be very involved, and the result will be good. He is going to use the coming pressures as a refining fire to purify his church. God wants to seize the hearts of his church, to recapture the hearts of his people. C.S. Lewis, in his book series about Narnia, tells the story of a horse and his boy who want to go to Narnia. But to get there, they have to undertake a perilous journey that's filled with hardship and danger. One of the key points in the book is when the boy and horse have to go through a very dangerous mountain area at night. It's dark, they can't see anything, and there are sheer cliffs. But the great lion Aslan takes them through to the other side. Now, God underlined this picture for me during my imprisonment. A year before I was arrested, someone had referred to this story when praying over us, that I had a perilous journey ahead of me, but that I would press through, that I would keep going because God would be with me. And we wrote it down. And right before we were arrested, Noreen just happened to grab this prayer among some other random pages as she left our home in a flurry on her way to a prayer retreat. In God's timing, this is what she was praying through right before my perilous journey began. I thought of it often in prison. There was hardship. There was real danger. And at times, I came close to defeat. What God wanted to highlight for me was the lion, that the lion was there and would take me through to the other side. My brothers and sisters, we are on a perilous journey. There will be hardship and danger, but the lion is with us. At some point, it will end, and it will end in victory for the lion and for those who are on his side. He will not be defeated. Keep that picture of the Lion of Judah before you, especially during the next session when I will talk about perhaps the most obvious spiritual danger of fear and how I learned to deal with it.